Last week we looked at Israel's journey. From Sinai to the plains of Moab, that area east of the Jordan River across from Jericho. After spending 40 years in the wilderness as a result of rebelling against God's plan to give them the land, a rebellion that was instigated by, you remember, the 10 spies report, the Israelites are now poised to enter the land. And Deuteronomy, as I mentioned last week, Deuteronomy is Moses' farewell address and charge to the people, in which he essentially retells the teachings and the events of Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers. And as I said last week, Deuteronomy, it has three lengthy speeches from Moses, and I talked about a couple of those, got interrupted in the second. I'm not going to talk about the rest that I was going to talk about in the second speech. But in the third speech, which is from 27:1 down through 31:30 of Deuteronomy, in that speech he gives instructions for a covenant renewal ceremony that's to be performed when the Israelites have entered into the promised land. And he then lists the blessings that will accompany faithfulness and the curses that will accompany rebellion. And he also urges them again to faithfulness. You see this over and over again, these urgings, where the people are told, you need to be faithful, hold on, remember, remember, be faithful, be faithful. And he does that again in that speech. He urges them to faithfulness, and he makes provision for the future of the nation. He wrote the law, and he gave it to the priests with instructions that it be read every 7 years to all of Israel at the Feast of Booths. So the word of God needs to go out into the community. Now the book ends with the book of Deuteronomy ends with the song of Moses and the testament of Moses, in which he bestowed his final blessings on Israel. And it also has the last in 34:1-12, the account of Moses' death, which is interesting. Moses was 120 when he died, and he was buried apparently by God in an unknown location. And the uniqueness of Moses' burial, it's alluded to in Jude verse 9, where he says there, it refers to a confrontation between the archangel Michael and the devil over Moses' body. Now perhaps God wanted Moses' burial site to remain unknown so the people wouldn't unduly venerate Moses. Perhaps he wanted it unknown because he wanted to free them of the temptation of bringing Moses' bones into the promised land, because God had told him, you're not going into the promised land. But in any event, he's buried at some unknown location. This morning we're going to take a look at the book of Joshua. And for those who are just arriving, or this is the first class, this is the story we're doing a big overview. So we're moving quickly. And today we're going to look at the entire book of Joshua. Now, Joshua is, of course, Moses' successor as the leader of Israel. You saw him, he was appointed to that in a number of places. Deuteronomy chapter 34, verse 9 says, and Joshua, the son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands on him. So the people of Israel obeyed him and did as the Lord had commanded Moses. Now in Joshua chapter 1, God tells Joshua, he says, look, Moses has now died. Moses, who was not going to be allowed to come into the promised land for his unfaithfulness, his disobedience, he's now died, so it's time for the people of Israel to enter the promised land. And he assures Joshua, God assures him that he will be with him, and he exhorts him three times to be strong and courageous. That tells you that there's something going on here. Strong and courageous. It's not some deal where you sit here and say, look, you just sit here and you have nothing to do and I will take care of everything. You must be strong and courageous. And he tells him that three times. He assures him he'll be with him. He tells him, look, you be strong and courageous three times. And he commands him to obey all the law that he had revealed to Moses. And in that regard, he commands him to meditate on the book of the law day and night. Meditate on the book of the law day and night. So you see, Scripture is God's message. So we meditate on it. That's what he tells him. Now Joshua, he reminds the tribes of Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh. You remember that they had territory? Remember they came over here and they took this territory over here? They said it looks really good. And so he says you can have the tribe, the land territory east of the Jordan. So Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, Joshua reminds them, he says, look, despite the fact that you've been given that land east of the Jordan, you're obligated to come over onto the west side of the Jordan and help your fellow Israelites conquer Canaan. They said, okay, you know, they renewed their commitment to do that. They said, yeah, we're willing to do that. And then they tell Joshua, only you be strong and courageous. You be strong and courageous. In chapter 2, Joshua sends two men to spy out the land, reconnoiter the land. They're going to go, and especially Jericho. So he sends these two men to spy out the land, focusing on Jericho, and they come to the house of a prostitute, a woman named Rahab. Well, the king of Jericho, you know, he's got people. And he hears that these people have come in and entered the land, and he goes to Rahab, sends men there, and they said, you bring those guys out, because we know what's up. They're spying out the land, and that's no good. So the king sends his men, says, bring them out. But Rahab hid the spies. She hides the spies, and she tells the king's emissaries, his servants, look, they took off that way, and hurry up, and you might be able to catch them. Okay, so she hides God, and she tells the people. She hides the spies, and then she has the spies agree that they will spare her family when they conquer the land. She says, listen, we all know you're going to conquer the land. We're over here in absolute fear. All of the inhabitants of the land are in absolute fear because we know what God is doing. So when that happens, you give me your word, I've done solid by you. Now when that happens, you spare me and my family. And they agree to that, and then the spies return. And Joshua understood that Rahab's comment about the fear of the inhabitants of the land, he understood that that was confirmation from God that he was giving them the land. So when they come back and they say, yeah, this is what happened, Rahab, although she told us they're all quaking with fear over there. And he said, all right, yeah, I see. That's God just saying to you, you see? They understand, that's what I'm going to do. Now the next day, after that, he sends out the two spies, they come back. The next day, the Israelites move from Shittim to the bank of the Jordan. And then after 3 days, the people headed out, following far behind the Levitical priests who were carrying the Ark of the Covenant. They had to keep a large distance because of the holiness. Now, the Ark of the Covenant is, of course, this ornate box or chest that represents God's particular presence among the people of Israel. It is this focused representation of God's presence. So the priests carry it. The people march out far behind the priests. And when the priest carrying the ark, when they entered the Jordan River, God stopped the river from flowing. And it was at flood stage. And he stops the river from flowing, and the water's just piling up. And so what happens then? He stops it from flowing. This all goes down. He dries the riverbed so that the entire people of Israel march across the dry Jordan. You see, and you see the parallel, obviously, with Moses as he did at the Red Sea. When Moses was their leader, so now he does at the Jordan with Joshua as their leader. And they come into the promised land. And pursuant to the Lord's instruction that was given through Joshua, 12 Israelite men, there's one from each tribe, they gathered 12 stones, one stone each from the dry Jordan at the place where the priests carrying the ark had stood. And with those stones, then Joshua, he says, go, one from each tribe, you each get a stone, put them on your shoulder. They get these stones from the dry riverbed. And with those stones, Joshua erected at Gilgal. And you can see that here. There on the map, he erects at Gilgal, which is just east and north, very close to Jericho, and it's also the first place where the Israelites camped west of the Jordan. But he erects there a memorial for future generations to God's great work on their behalf. He creates this stone monument of the 12 stones taken out one by a member of each tribe of God's bringing them into the land. And it's this thing that future generations, you see, will be able to look. When they say, well, you know, did that really happen? What's going on? Look at that. The people who crossed put that there. And I want you to recognize, of course, that the Lord's Supper is no less. It's maybe more But it's no less than a transgenerational reminder of God's work. You see, that we share in that because it's like, well, what happened? No, this came from the hand of the Lord and was passed down, see, by people, by people, by people, and we share in that. So they erect this monument there. Chapter 5, all the males who'd been born in Israel during the time of the wilderness wandering, they were circumcised in keeping with the covenant requirements. And then on the 14th day of the first month, the Israelites, they celebrated the Passover at Gilgal. And the next day, they ate food that was taken from the land. And the day after that, the manna that God had provided, this bread from heaven, this miraculous provision of God, after they had taken that food from the land, that ceased. And see, this is all part of an indication that this is a new era. Something different has happened. They're now into the land that God had promised to give them centuries ago. Centuries ago. Now, the strategy for subjugating Canaan was to divide and conquer. They were going to divide and conquer by first taking the central portion of the land. That's what's described here in this diagram as a central campaign. The Israelites, they're in Gilgal, which is very close to Jericho. So Jericho's on lockdown. You got this horde of people out there. Jericho's on lockdown. Now, Jericho was a fortified city. Not all cities were like that. Jericho was a fortified city, meaning it has walls and it has locked gates that are designed to keep attackers at bay. It is a military defensive structure. So here it is. It is a fortified city. They're on lockdown. And by God's instruction, Joshua, he had the Israelites march around the city once a day for 6 days with the Ark of the Covenant leading the way. Once a day for 6 days, you go around. The priests who accompanied the Ark, they're blowing this whole time on their animal horns. Once a day for 6 days, Ark of the Covenant leading the way, the priests who accompany the Ark, they're blowing on these horns. And then on the seventh day, the group marched around the city the same way. Ark of the Covenant in front, priests accompanying, blowing the horns. But this time they did it seven times. And after the seventh march, on the seventh day, the horns apparently fall silent. They've completed that. Joshua tells the people it's time to shout. The priests then sounded this distinctive long blow on the animal horns, and that was the indication, shout! The people all shout! And God brings the walls down. God brings the walls down. As the writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews 11:30, by faith, the walls of Jericho fell after being encircled for 7 days. God tells him, you go out, here's what you do. There's a fortified city. I don't have a battering ram. I don't have, what am I going to do? Here's what you do. You march around the city. What? Yeah, don't march around the city. Okay, you're God. Around the city, around the city, around the city. And on the seventh day, go around seven times. Then when the priests blow that long thing, you shout and watch. There it is. By faith. Why does the writer of Hebrews say that? It's because they trusted God. When God tells them stuff, they say, okay, I don't understand how it's going to work. I can't calculate. You know, normally I can sit there and go, okay, I've got a battering ram here, and it's this wide, and it produces this much force, and I can calculate that the walls are this way, so I can puncture the wall. Don't worry about any of that. You march around, and I'm going to take care of it. And the walls fell, just as God has said. Now, everybody in the city, with the city completely exposed, everybody in the city except Rahab and her family were killed. Rahab and her family are spared in keeping with the spies' promise. And she goes on, by the way, to live in Israel. This prostitute who had trusted in God and recognized his work and his reality and that he was going to give the land to them, so much so she risked her life to hide the spies. This prostitute goes on to live in the land, and as Matthew chapter 1 verse 5 indicates, to become an ancestor of the Lord Jesus Christ. This prostitute turns to God, and she's in the lineage of the one we worship. I just think it's cool. Yeah, so that's something. Chapter 7, Israel sends this force of only about 3,000 men to attack this small town of Ai. Now, they only sent 3,000 men because their judgment, they had looked at it and they thought that was all that would be needed to accomplish the task. But Israel was defeated. 36 Israelites were killed during that battle. And you can see what that did to the people. They're just, uh-oh. Here we are coming in here, conquering this land, and this town routs us. This isn't good. So the people are just absolutely disheartened. And we learn that the reason that happened was that Achan had sinned in keeping some of the booty from Jericho for himself rather than devoting everything to the Lord as the Lord had commanded. The Lord said, listen, when you go and take Jericho, you're going to see all this kind of stuff. None of it do you keep. You devote everything to the Lord. Well, he didn't do that. He hoarded some of it for himself. Well, he winds up doing that. And Achan and his family, the family presumably because they were culpable in the matter, he was hiding this stuff in his tent. Now, presumably the family was culpable, but he and his family were executed by the people. They were stoned and burned, and then a pile of rocks were put there. And the writer says, and it's still there. You see, they were eliminated. And then with that sin purge from the camp, Israel then again attacks the city of Ai, and this time they're victorious. And that's also the time, by the way, that they captured neighboring Bethel. And you have to kind of read there. If you look at 8:17 and 12:16, you can see that Bethel was included and taken there. Now we see in the last part of chapter 8 that Israel had gone up some 25 miles north of Bethel up to Mount Ebal. And so this is the idea that their campaign had gone ahead and gone up there, which is where Shechem is, between Ebal and Gerizim. So that they'd gone that far north. And while they're there, Joshua conducts this covenant renewal ceremony that Moses had commanded in Deuteronomy chapter 27. Sacrifices were offered. The law was copied. You see how important this is. The law was copied there at that time. Blessings and curses were recited by half the group in front of Mount Gerizim, separated by the Ark of the Covenant. You got half of the group on one side in front of Mount Gerizim, half of the group on the other side in front of Mount Ebal, and they're reciting the blessings and curses. You're faithful, these are the blessings. You're not faithful, these are the curses, as Moses had told them. And so they wind up doing that, citing the blessings and the curses, and then the law was read, and then they returned to Gilgal, kind of their home base for the first 7 years. They're back at Gilgal. Now, Gibeon was a major city. It's not on this map. I think it'll be on the next one. Gibeon was a major city, a powerful city in central Canaan, and it's only about 15 miles southwest of Gilgal. So here, now the Gibeonites are there, and they're concerned. They're fearing imminent destruction. They've heard. They understand what's in store. So they're fearing imminent destruction, so they send a delegation to the Israelites and they tell them, look, we've come from a long way. Oh, man, it was a tough journey. You look at our stuff, it's all rotted and our bread's no good. And, you know, look, all this stuff was fresh when we started out, but we came from so far away that, look, I mean, So now the Israelites, they didn't consult the Lord. And because they didn't, they were fooled. And they entered into a covenant, a peace treaty with the Gibeonites, where in God's name, they promised and swore to them that they would not kill them. So they wind up doing that, and that was a mistake. And a few days later, they learn the truth about where the Gibeonites are from. It's right there in Canaan. Right there. Well, that puts them in something of a pickle, right? Because God had commanded Israel to destroy the inhabitants of Canaan, and yet they had agreed in God's name to spare them. Well, that, what do you do? Okay, well, Joshua and the leaders, they considered that the best solution in that case was to allow the Gibeonites to live because we had committed that to them in God's name, but we'll enslave them. And that's what they did. That's what they did. Now, after this covenant with Gibeon being a significant city, well, the people in the south, they're concerned about this because Gibeon has now gone and aligned with the Israelites. Ooh, this is really not something that's, this isn't a good thing that they've done that. They've aligned with all of Israel. Let's see here. Let me see where I am. Okay, so after that, they've aligned. And so we have a coalition of five Amorite kings. They come up and they attack Gibeon. They say, listen, we don't like this, that these people are allied. So they get five of them get together. They go up and attack Gibeon. And then Israel, because of their covenant treaty with them, they respond and they defend Gibeon. And God gives them the victory over these five Amorite kings. You see, God's working in all this. He gave them the victory. Who defeated Sihon? Who defeated Og? East of the Jordan, God. Who's giving them the victories here? God. It's obvious, isn't it? They lose at Ai. Why? Because they were unfaithful. When they're faithful, what does God do? Okay, I told you I was giving you this land. And so this is what happens. These Amorite kings come up. And in fact, God gives Israel the victory, and he kills many Amorite soldiers as they're fleeing by dropping hailstones on them. So they're thinking they're getting away, and God says, no. Kills many of them that way. And this, by the way, is when God stopped the sun in the sky to extend the daylight hours to help Joshua to victory. Now, I just love these, types who say, I can't do it. Look, you're going to have to trust me on this, that the one who spoke this creation into existence, he wants to stop the sun. Well, how could you do it? Your momentum. I think he can probably stop it. I think he can probably take care of whatever your physical beefs are with it. He can do it. He spoke it into existence. I remember many years ago I was talking to this guy, and he told me, he got to the point saying, no, if Jesus came to earth, if he came here in physical presence, he couldn't walk on water. He'd have to obey the laws of physics. I said, he spoke the laws into existence. But that's the same kind of idea. But anyway, this is where you have that extended day. The five Amorite kings who had done this, they're executed. The town of Mekedah was captured. And then the Israelites, they continued advancing in a southern direction, conquering the cities of Libna, Lachish. They're not all on here. Most of them are. Libna, Lachish, Gezer, Eglon, Hebron, and Debir. This is the southern campaign. So the Amorite kings come up. We're after you. Get whipped. And then they say, great, now we're coming south. And so they come here and they conquer this territory. And in Joshua chapter 10, verse 42 and 43, it says, and Joshua captured all these kings and their lands at one time because the Lord God of Israel fought for Israel. That's why. Because the Lord God of Israel fought for Israel. Then Joshua returned and all Israel with him to the camp at Gilgal. And so this is where their home base. Now, with Israel in control of the central and southern regions now of Canaan, well, King Jabin of Hazor. Hazor was the largest city in northern Canaan and maybe in all of Canaan. Well, King Jabin, he then goes out and he recruits a number of other kings into a military alliance because, these people fight and all this stuff. But when they see this kind of danger, they say, hey, we better get together, because our survival is at risk. So that then kind of brings them together, and he puts together this military alliance, and there is a huge army with many horses and many chariots, and they assembled at the waters of Merom to await Israel's anticipated push north, because Israel controls central, southern, they're waiting, and so they're there with this large army, many horses, many chariots, and Joshua attacks them suddenly. And God gave Israel the victory. The Israelites, they then pursued. They pursued the people they had defeated as far as Sidon to the northwest. I see him cutting that off. And the valley of Mizpah to the northeast. So here's Joshua. He comes up here. You have this big battle. Pursues the people that way. Pursues them that way. And then he doubles back and he captures Hazor. And in fact, captures Hazor and burns the city. So this is the northern campaign. He kills the king in Hazor and all who are in the city. And let me give you just an overview. This will be a larger picture where you get to see all three. So here you see when they come in, they first have the central campaign, goes up to Shechem, Jericho, Bethel, Ai. Then you have the southern campaign where they come down this direction. And then you have the northern campaign where they go up here. And with this, they've pretty much subjugated Canaan. As God had told them years ago, he's going to give them that land, they've pretty much subjugated. Now, the subjugation of Canaan that's compressed in these accounts, it actually took 6 or 7 years. And you can see that from something that's said. But it took 6 or 7 years, and in all of it, as I say, God is the one giving the victory. He is fulfilling the promises that he made to the patriarch centuries earlier. Now this idea, when you think of these time frames of centuries, God says, I'm going to do this. Okay, great, let's do it. You know, I'm kind of impatient. Let's go. I got my stuff. I'm doing my thing, not your thing. And so here he is, but he brings him in as sure as I'm standing here. And then in chapters 13 to 21 of the book of Joshua, you see that Israel divides the land. Chapter 13, verses 1 to 7, though Israel now controlled Canaan, they controlled Canaan, they still did not fully possess Canaan. And that's important. You know, militaries can come in and take control over large areas, but there are still groups and pockets, you see, that are not eliminated, but you still are in control. And that's what happens here. They controlled Canaan, but they didn't fully possess it. Various peoples, groups of people, continued to inhabit more remote areas. And God tells Joshua, he says that he will drive them out, and then he instructs, I'll drive them out. Yes, they're still there. I'm aware of that. You control, though. I will drive them out. So you go ahead now and you assign the land of Canaan to the various tribes of Israel. And here's what Arnold and Beyer in their book on the Encountering the Old Testament, they say, Israel's individual tribes receive the challenge to complete the conquest by exterminating these smaller groups. As we will see, Israel did not succeed in driving out these peoples, and pagan influences soon corrupted God's people. This is the story of Israel in Canaan. This is what winds up happening. Now here is the allotment you can see. In chapter 13, verse 8 through 32, you get the allotment of the land that was east of the Jordan, that was taken from Sihon and from Og. So you have here this land over here to Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh. You see, they get this land here, Gilead and Bashan. And so that was something that was given to them. And then we have the allotment of the land west of the Jordan. That takes in chapters 14 through 19. You then have the land west of the Jordan being allotted. And the land allotments, they're given out by Eleazar the priest, which I think is significant, and Joshua. So he gives those out. Now, which tribe was assigned to what area? This was done by lot. This was determined by lot, as God had instructed Moses in Numbers chapter 26, 55 to 56, and in Numbers 33, verse 54. Of course, the casting of lots, this was a matter of divine guidance. For example, in Proverbs 16, 33, you remember in Acts chapter 1, the selection of Matthias. You see, this was God's choosing, but he was choosing through that intermediate mechanism. And the tribes include Ephraim and Manasseh, the two sons of Joseph. They don't include the Levites. See, the tribes are counted different ways at different times. So the Levites aren't included here, so they're out. And Joseph's out because they represent him. So you've got those two, Joseph and Levi, out, so that's 12. So Ephraim and Manasseh are there. And the Levites, they're out because they don't receive territory. Instead, what they get is that they get 48 cities and the surrounding pasture land of those cities. They get 48 cities that are given to them, and those are scattered among the tribes, all of the tribes. So they don't get a territory, they get cities that are scattered among the tribes. Now Caleb, the one faithful spy in addition to Joshua, you remember that Caleb, he says, well, he was given the city of Hebron. If I can spot Hebron right here, he's given the city of Hebron. And he says at 85 years old that if the Lord would be with him, he would indeed possess that city. And that's what happened. You see that in Joshua 15, 13, and 14. Now, there are several texts, by the way, that bring up this idea that I mentioned, that note that certain tribes did not drive out various groups inhabiting their territory. You see that in 1563, 1610, 17, 12, and 13, and the eventual acceptance of the religious practices of these groups, it had a terrible effect on Israel's faith. It corrupted them, it polluted them, as God understood and told them, you got to get rid of them. And I will get rid of them for you. You hold firmly to what I say, and you go ahead and do that, and I'll see that it gets done. And they didn't do it. They didn't do it, and it became a real mess for them. Now, after the territory had been allotted to Reuben and Gad and Manasseh and Ephraim and Judah, those five tribes. So we had an allotment that's going on from Gilgal. We've got Eleazar, we've got Joshua doing this. You have the allotment done of those five tribes. And after that, Israel then relocated. They relocated from Gilgal, which had been their base of operations for the 6 or 7 years when they had been taking the land and gaining control of the land, to Shiloh, which is right here. So they go from Gilgal, which had been their base, and they relocate their base of operation to Shiloh. And that's where they erect the tabernacle there in Shiloh, and it remained there for many years. And then the remaining territories of the seven other tribes are allotted from Shiloh. I just wanted you to be aware of when Israel moved its base of operations to Shiloh, because that comes up at different times. But that's where they are now. That's where the tabernacle is. And by God's command, Joshua was given the city for which he asked, Timnath-Serah, which is in the hill country of Ephraim, and he built the city there and settled in it. So here we now have the land, the territory's been allotted. And in chapters 20 and 21, in those two chapters, you've got these cities. Chapter 20, you get these cities that are identified as the cities of refuge. And those are these, there's three on each side, the ones with the circles. You've got Golan, Ramoth, Gilead, Bezer, and up here it's Kadesh, and Shechem, and Hebron. Three on each side of the Jordan River. And what these are, see, these are cities of refuge. They're places to which someone who'd accidentally killed somebody, that it's a place where they could flee to be protected from the avenger of blood. The avenger of blood is a relative of the dead person who would be seeking a life for a life. And so they say, if you accidentally kill somebody, what you can do is you can make it to this city, and there you're protected. Now, there were conditions on it that you had to remain there until the high priest died, and you had to come and basically convince the elders of the city that, yes, you hadn't killed this guy, willfully, and then you're able to come in. But that's what these things are. And like I said, there's three on each side. It was a sanctuary. It was a place of asylum. In chapter 21, the cities in which the various clans of Levi, where they're to live. Remember, they don't get territory. They just get the 48 cities scattered around. Well, then in chapter 21, the places where they were to live, they were given by lot. And it's interesting, see, because they're being dispersed all over the territories. And by being dispersed that way, they were available to help people with spiritual matters and to arbitrate disputes. So that's kind of, so he's got all, there's kind of sprinkled all through there, kind of like, salt or something all over the territories of that you have the people of Israel. And then in chapter 22, Joshua tells the tribes of Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, he says, okay, it's time now. You guys have done enough. We are in sufficient control that we consider Canaan, the land west of the Jordan, we consider it subjugated. So it's now time for you guys to go ahead and return to the territories that had been allotted to you east of the Jordan. Reuben, Gad, the half-tribe of Manasseh, you had the property. You said, yes, you can have it, but first you got to come over here and help us conquer this land. All right, now it's time. You've done enough. You can go ahead back to your place. And so on their way back, those tribes, right at the Jordan River, they erect a large altar. Right at the Jordan River, they construct this very large altar, you see. And so this is a thing in before, and on their way back, I wanted to give you this text. When Joshua sends them back, I just like this. He says, he's telling Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh, okay, it's time for you to go head back. You go to that territory east of the Jordan. But he says to them, only be very careful to observe the commandment and the law that Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you, to love the Lord your God and to walk in all his ways and to keep his commandments and to cling to him and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul. And I say that because of this notion that sometimes pops up that service to God under the old covenant was somehow this heartless, just rules nonsense. Always, God has called his people to serve him from the heart. And so you see this, and he tells them, you're going over there, and you need to do that. Now, that's when on the way back, they build that altar that I mentioned, this large altar. Well, when the Israelites who are in Canaan, when they learn about this altar, they're ready to go to war. They're going to go to war with these people over this altar. Because, see, they're ready to do that because this, in doing this, they say, listen, they are disobeying the command, God's command to worship or to offer burnt offerings only at the place specified by the Lord. You see that in Deuteronomy chapter 12, verses 13 and 14. So here they are, they're offering, they're worshiping and they're offering burnt offerings at some place not specified by the Lord. And the consequence of that's going to be just like when Achan sinned. We're all going to be in on that. And so they're ready to go to war with the people. But fortunately, they sent a delegation of leaders over to the people to confront them about this issue. And they basically go over and they said, what are you doing? You know, what in the world are you doing? Doing this kind of thing. And they learned from the tribes east of the Jordan that this wasn't a functioning altar. This is a model. This is a monument. We're not offering sacrifices. We just created a monument or a model of the altar. And we did that because our concern is that as generations go on, you guys on the west side of the Jordan are going, perhaps, you people aren't part of us. You're not part of God's people. You're them, and we are the people of God. And they said, that's what we're doing. So in the future, when generations down the road, they say that we have nothing to do with God, we're going to point to this thing. And in 22:28, it says, behold, the copy of the altar of the Lord, which our fathers made, not for burnt offerings, not for sacrifices. It's not a real functioning altar. It's just a monument. Not for sacrifice offerings or sacrifice, but as a witness between us and you. It's a witness between us. In fact, the tribes there, Reuben and Gad, it was known as, that altar was known as witness. So that's what they were trying to do. They were trying to say, listen, when this happens, I want to point to that and say, no, here's the story. We're with you. We had this. And we constructed that right there at the Jordan so you would always know. We're one with you. We are one people. And so that's what they did. And that satisfied the people. In fact, they're quite happy with that. It avoided a civil war. Now, Joshua, he issues his final challenges to God's people. There are two speeches he gives in chapter 23, and one in 23 and one in 24. Near the end of his life, Joshua summons the people of Israel, and he reminded them how the Lord had fought for them so that they gained control of Canaan. That was God's doing. That was his work. So he reminds them of that, and he said that God would drive out the various groups that remained in the land, but they needed to be diligent in keeping God's law so as not to mix with the remaining nations or be pulled into worship of their gods. You see, you be diligent in observing God's law so that you not mix with those that still remain. You not be pulled into worshiping their gods. And as you do that, God will drive them out. So they will then no longer be there. So this is what they were doing. This is what Joshua tells them. If they do that, God will drive them out. And if they don't do that, they'll become a trap that will lead to Israel's exile from the land. And we know the story. You see, that will lead to Israel's exile. Well, in his second speech in chapter 24, he assembled the people at Shechem. And he reminds the people, he reminds them of God's mighty works and of his faithfulness to his promises. And then Joshua called the people to renew their covenant and their commitment to God. Say again today, you, not your dad, not your mom, you, I want you to commit yourself publicly, clearly. And here's what Joshua says in this very famous text. In fact, 24:14 is on my 24:15 is on my refrigerator. He says, "Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve Yahweh." No room for other gods. Put them away. Serve Yahweh. "And if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord," that's something you consider a bad choice. If that's the way it is, "then you choose this day whom you'll serve, whether the gods your father served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we're serving God." We're serving God. And so why is Joshua, this great leader, this man of God, telling them that? Because that is the spirit and the heart that we have to have in serving God. I don't care what you do. I don't care how you pull me, bully me, push me, call me names, do all of that. I'm serving God. And our society, we're going to have to be stronger and stronger about that. You see that? Or am I the only one paying attention? And we're going to have to be willing to stand and say, "You say what you want. Do what you want. Fire me from my job, but I will not abandon God." And so this is what he tells them there. Now the people declared, look, they too would serve the Lord. And when Joshua warned them of the dire consequences of not doing that, if they turned from God, they declared again that they would serve him. "No, no, no, we're going to serve God." And when Joshua urged them again, he put away all the foreign gods. The people declared a third time in verse 24, "The Lord our God we will serve, and his voice we will obey." Okay. All right, that's good. All right, remember that. You remember that. Because that's what they're saying. Now Joshua, he wrote these words in the book of the law, and he set up a large stone as a memorial of their covenant renewal. And then chapter 24, the last part there in 28 to 33, we've got three burials that take place. There are three burials at the end here. Joshua is buried. He dies at the age of 110. Moses had lived to 120. Joshua dies at 110. The bones of Joseph, you remember the bones that were brought out of Egypt when Joseph said, "Listen, I know what's going to happen because God had said it, and I know God, and when God says something, it's money. When he says it, it's money." That's the way we would say it. That means you can take it to the bank, you see. And so he says, "So when that happens, you bring my bones out because I want to be buried in the promised land." And so they buried Joseph's bones there, and they also buried Eleazar, the son of Aaron. And then we see in verse 31, it's this great inspired tribute to Joshua's leadership and influence. I heard that bell. This is the last text. He says, "Israel served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua and had known all the work that the Lord did for Israel." Now that's a serious compliment to somebody's influence in people's lives. Joshua. And that's the kind of thing you see that we as Christians, we have to be people who hold to God, put him above everything, and that influence he then radiates out. And it's absolutely essential. Now next week we're going to follow the story into the book of Judges. Thanks for coming.